Hey, Earth people! I remember to turn my light on, but I forgot my almonds.
Shit. I brought them upstairs.
And I sat them on the counter. Because I have to have my almonds as a snack. So, YouTube sucks. I made a banner for him. Where's the banner? I'll show the banner. anyway, YouTube banned me last night because I was talking, whatever. So they kicked me off my live stream, which is okay. Except I talked for an hour after they kicked me off because I didn't know they'd kick me off. So I didn't have to upload and copy and delete and do all the other crap that I normally have to do. So, oh, look. Hey, from the horsies. Smells like alfalfa. That's what alfalfa looks like. Alrighty. So, let's see. Looks like I got how many people? 60 people. First comment. Hopefully YouTube doesn't shut you down. Yeah, exactly. Piece of shit. You left us hanging. I talked for an hour after they shut me off. I finished the whole live and went, oh, they shut my comments off. I go, oh, well, it still shows me live. So I kept doing my live. I finished it. And then when I went off and went to YouTube, it was like, your live was shut off, killed. I was going to copy it and repost it. And they deleted it immediately. So my entire live last night, I talked to my freaking self, wasting my damn time. Minnesota, snowing. You know, it's kind of cold and windy here. I was going to go to the grocery store and pick up some vegetables and maybe make like a gumbo, a chicken gumbo. But man, I opened my freezer and I was like, man, I got a lot of meat in here that I haven't eaten in a long time. I got to start working through what the hell I got in there. So I pulled out some like brisket, and it's sitting on a counter downstairs thawing out, so I'm gonna fry it up, or not fry it up, just heat it up and maybe eat some veggies somehow, whatever. Minnesota, hit the thumbs up, you know. What the hell? Am I on? It says I got 128 people, but it shows me at the bottom that Rick is waiting to come in, like I have a guest. The hell just happened? Rick's gone. Am I back? Here. You're on. They just kicked me off again and put me back on. Freaking YouTube. I can't stand them. It's probably because I put up that little banner thing. I'll put it up again. Freaking YouTube. Pieces of shit. All right. I thought this was supposed to be a ticker, but it's not a ticker. Tickler. All right. So I was going through the comments. Stupid YouTube. I know, man. It was crazy. Looks like the floor of my office. What looks like a floor? My floor? Can you still do next Sunday? No, they kicked me off. I can't do lives. I tried to go live last night again after that one ended to tell you kind of what happened. And YouTube blocked me, gave me a strike. I can't post for like 2 weeks. Whatever. Let's see. Good morning, New Mexico, California. I was banned from Instagram for no reason. But Let's see, Wisconsin. Rick is gone. I don't know what the hell happened. I lost you. I know, I lost me too. It just went blank and I got a big screen. It said something went wrong. And so I had to go back into my thing, back into StreamYard, back into, and I came back up and it showed that I still had 140 people there. You're back. They cut you off for a minute. I forgot what I was talking about. What are you doing? I'm sitting here eating some almonds, drinking my coffee, waiting for my lunch to defrost. I fed the horses. They said we might get rain. It's cloudy, windy, cold. 5x5 means I'm loud and clear. Hello from the Netherlands. I love my little Switzerland, Netherlands people. Not again. Rick is alive. Is that supposed to be Rick is alive or Rick is alive? My screen went dark. I know. CIA. You know why the CIA is watching me? Because I was talking to someone on the phone this morning and we were talking about anthrax. And I was like, I think anthrax is a powder, but I don't remember if it was airborne or if it was spores or you have to come in contact with the dust. And so I asked Alexa, stop. I asked her to define it, and then she gave me the animal, and then it went into anthrax as a zoonotic disease. And so the person I was talking to was like, zoonotic, does that mean that it's only humans? Or and I was like, no, I said, I think it means that it can be passed from human to other species. Because like rabies is zoonotic, because a raccoon can get it, a dog can get it, and they can pass it to other animals, including humans. But some things like viruses can't go to other species. So that makes it zoonotic. Sorry, I'm eating. People are going to complain. So then I was like, I asked what the definition of anthrax, how do you make it? What's the difference between animal anthrax and powdered? And then, so I did all these searches and everything. So I'm sure, you know, all these little flags for the government is going off right now. He's trying to make anthrax. Because sharing information now has become a crime. Because government wants everybody freaking dead. American woman in New Jersey. Checking in. Rick, I hope you can go live. Nope. Love coming from Texas. Man, I had a great couple days of pickleball last couple days. Really good. I had a couple pickleball stories. What were my pickleball stories? That was kind of funny. Good morning, good morning. I bet someone reported you. Whatever. Let them report me. Missouri. Miserable Missouri. Maybe a cop live on Twitter. You know, I just figured out how to do a live through Rumble on Twitter. So I added my Twitter account. So I might do a little spontaneous live on Twitter to see how that goes. I was eating a pizza yesterday and I took a bite and the cheese was like really hot and it touched my lip and now it burnt. I got freaking, man, every time I move, I got this little burn pot on my lip. Been having problems all day with my connections. Really? You know, there's a lot of talk. What happened to my little lip gloss that I had up here? Well, that sucks. Shit. I had some good lip gloss up there, and it's gone. I thought I might have. I mean, I've got this, which is, this has sun protection, so I don't usually use this unless I'm going outside. My other one is just nice and soft and smooth and, oh, there it is. Shit. I was like, how the hell could that thing disappear? It's over here. This is my good watermelon one. But it doesn't have any sunblock. So it's just like moisturizer for the old lips. The other one's has sunblock. It's a little more thick. But I digress. So I might do a spontaneous. Man, this little cushion is really pissing me off. So this little thing is supposed to like keep my hips balanced because I was having that hip issue. And they said if you sit on one of these, it somehow fixes your hips. But it slides from one side to the left. So I end up sitting on this side and it makes my hips off. So I'm constantly, if I get up fast or sit down fast, I have to readjust it to where it's in the middle. There. All right. Technical problems. Rick, you should fix all that before you go live so we don't have... Whatever. Crazy people. Connecticut. Coming to ban you. Yeah, they banned me for sure. Big old strike. A better horsey owner. Good. I'm glad to hear that horsey people get something out of my horsey videos. Lester picked Rita's front feet. Is that like something new or good? Could they not pick his feet? I didn't know that was a problem. Let's see. No, they said it wasn't because of the stabbing. It was because they were having sex before they got stabbed. That's why they kicked me off. It violated their porn policy. Even though if you Google naked yoga on YouTube, that's not a problem. I showed some black and white footage of a guy having sex with a woman and then her husband busts in and stabs them both. And they killed my live and banned me and gave me a strike because of 2 seconds of him having sex with her before the guy busted in. It wasn't because of the stabbing. It was because of the sex. But go ahead and Google naked yoga on YouTube, and you'll see women completely naked doing the splits and doing yoga completely naked. And that's okay. That's the problem with censorship, is the people in charge always get to pick and choose what they like and don't like and what they allow and don't allow. It's never fair. It's never equal, no matter what they say. Which is why YouTube sucks. Sorry. Did you hear Lester Clean Water Challenge? I did. Somebody sent me that, and I thought that was a great video. I'm glad he did that, because I am a fanatic about making sure your horses have clean water. I hate nasty, dirty water. The nasty water I've seen on horses throughout my life is just so disgusting. I can see it and smell it and feel it in my hands right now. It is just horrible. So when he did that water challenge, I was like, good for him. Oh, Doris, you're in Singer, huh? Wow, I haven't checked my things later. Well, shit, if you're in Singer, maybe... Comment after the video post in the comments. You can't get blood from a stone. I don't know what that means. How am I trying to get blood from a stone? I was looking for a live on Rumble. I can't do lives on Rumble because they want a monthly fee. If in order to do a live on Rumble, I have to upgrade my StreamYard account, which is $20 a month, because right now it's free. And that's $20 a month for StreamYard. And then to do live on Rumble, you have to upgrade to the pro account on Rumble, which is $10 a month. So in order to do a live on Rumble, it's going to cost me $30 a month. I'm just not, that's a lot of money. I'm not going to pay that. That's crazy. So anyway, Let's see. Saturday, Three Forks, Montana. What happened last night? YouTube gave me a strike, cut me off. Let's see. Late. Real men don't wear lip gloss. It's not lip gloss. It's lip conditioner. What's it called? EOS. EOS. I get it on Amazon. I don't think it's lip gloss. It's not even glossy. It's just like moisturizer. Don't call me a woman because I'm putting lip gloss on. It's not like I'm out there getting pedicures and little, what do you call the finger cures, whatever it is. Where are we at here? I'm going to be forced to join Twitter to see. Yeah, you are. I mean, Twitter. Look, my Twitter feed is Horsey Guy. I don't post a whole bunch of horse stuff. But if you want to keep up with what's going on, I read the news a lot and I post a lot of news articles and I share anything that I think kind of connects the dots of problems on the horizon. So it's political. If you want to hide from that and it pretend it don't exist, there's some graphic videos that I put on there that I talk about what they did wrong and how they could have survived and crime and cops doing bad shit. So it's not for the faint of heart on my Twitter channel. However, it will educate you. It will make you more aware. It will make you better prepared to handle bad shit that's coming, in my opinion. But I'm not forced to go there. I don't care. I don't get any money from them. I don't care how many subscribers. I don't even know how many. I don't even know if they have subscribers on Twitter. I just post shit. I don't even know how many people watch. Or I mean, sometimes at the bottom, I might see, oh, it's been viewed 60 times or whatever. That's about the only feedback I get from Twitter. They don't harass me. I don't harass them. Your cushion is backwards. No, it's not. Don't tell me that. It's not backwards. Are you kidding me? This is supposed to be in the front. I thought it went like this, but it's not because this hump here causes a hump in your butt, and that's not supposed to be there. It's supposed to be like this. It's not backwards. You better check that out. Now you're going to make me question whether or not it's backwards. I'm pretty sure it's not. Damn it. Now I got to check. Hang on. I got to turn on my other screen. Now I got to. Oh, shit. What did I do? Oh, hang on. I'm coming back. Now I got to share screen, which I probably would have done anyway. Where's the damn cushion thingy? Seat. Cushion. Let's see if it gives me images. Images. Yeah. They're all forward. What's wrong with you? Crazy people telling me I don't know what the hell I'm doing. Although I have been known to make a mistake once in a while. Yeah, you notice the hump's always in the front. It's not backwards. This one looks backwards. Notice it's sitting in the chairs here. The hump's in the front and the opening's in the back. Why I gotta prove that I'm not a dummy? The opening's in the back. But I gotta admit, when it's right, of course it's off again. When it's right, it keeps me balanced. I just spend too much damn time behind a damn computer. I mean, the more videos I do, the more I do, I sit here, the more my hip and back hurts. If I don't do videos, I feel better and I walk better. I was going to do a live. It was nice outdoors brushing the horses because they're really furry and they need to be defurred. And I was going to do that. Boston's 31 degrees. Holy smokes. Lexa, what's the temperature?
Right now, it's 58 degrees Fahrenheit. Today, expect a high of 72 degrees.
So it's 58, it's going to be 72. It was so nice and sunny yesterday. Turn cushion around. I got another person telling me it's wrong. Are you kidding me? Do I have to go over that again? crazy people? Put Velcro on it. Yeah, that's too much trouble. Moki likes to lay on it. When he lays on it, he moves it kind of to one side and he curls up and he kind of likes wraps around the little hump thing. So he likes laying on it too. I cut my Twitter off when the last jerk who dictated over it wanted my personal information to allow me back on the platform because I harass Piglody. I don't know what the hell that all means. I mean, you do have to, they want to have verified users and they just don't want people to make fake accounts because they deleted millions of fake accounts because that's how the government and the FBI and the CIA was making all those fake accounts to promote bullshit and false information before Elon took over. So if you don't want to give personal information, then you probably don't want to be on Twitter. I don't have a problem. I gave my shit. I'm on here. I ain't worried about what I'm doing. I know. It's freaking crazy. Show us the yoga. What yoga? Oh, I forgot how to do the pose. Strike a pose. Is that like... my bandwidth is great. I've got fiber optic out here. So my bandwidth and my speed is like, I don't think that's ever the problem. But I mean, I could do a little speed test here and tell you what I got. Speed test. Run a speed test. So it is testing right now. And my speed test is download 303 megabytes is my download speed. And my upload speed is 283 megabytes. I think that's per second or something. So I don't think it's my speed. And I got the load planned. I can like go up to like 500-600 if I want to pay more, but I got the cheapy plan. Alex Jones has been doing Twitter lies on Hollywood Squares. A bunch of people. Come on. Yeah. I know Alex is on there. Rick, what did you do? I showed something that YouTube didn't like. Screen went blank. Something about sexual. Yeah. It's their porn. They said it was pornographic. It was sexual related. It violated their sexual policy. You know, if I'd have said I was a gay transgender using a little girl's bathroom, it would have been fine, but because I saw two adults in a freaking black and white blurry ass background, kind of, you could kind of tell the guy was doing the woman from behind for like 2 seconds. Shut me down, gave me a strike. Lester was always afraid of Rita. Oh. Does Rumble not let you live stream? No, not unless you get their upgrade plan. Rumble is free unless you want to live stream. Then you got to pay them 10 bucks a month so you can have the privilege to live stream. So I'm getting a lot of glitchy things. And this is more of my gun channel, not so much horse channel. But you should be prepared anyway for your horses in case you have water or your own well. There's mixed messages about this upcoming eclipse, whether it's going to cause problems or not. Now, this isn't the first time that I'm messing with this. Hey, this isn't the first time that we've been warned that it was going to be catastrophic and nothing happened. We were warned about the ozone layer going away, and we were warned about global climate change, and the water's going to rise, and we're going to be dead, and there's going to be no farmland, and there's no ice, and all the polar bears are going to... So warnings about shit that doesn't happen happen quite frequently. However, sometimes they do come true, and there is a few warnings about this eclipse. I think it's on April 8th coming up, that some government agencies are planning for power outages. They're saying get food for a week or water for a week, which I have no idea how that, an eclipse, would affect our grid or our ability to get water and food. But there are, I know Austin in Texas is doing it, but I think Austin is doing it because they're expecting, because we're in a path, the eclipse, so people are going to be traveling to this area, so they're expecting a huge drain on resources, et cetera, and maybe traffic jams, and maybe unrest because there's so many people in a small area because people are driving from everywhere because the eclipse is like there's a certain path across the U.S. that's going to hit. So that may be where the warnings are coming from because of the influx of people. But there's other kind of warnings out there. So, you know, they're recommending before the eclipse, make sure you have a lot of water and food in case something goes down or there's problems with the grid for a couple days. Now, if there's a large solar flare, it can fry our grid, take down electricity for weeks, months, even a year, if it's large enough. But for an eclipse, I'm not sure why that would happen, but just something to think about. You can research it. You can ignore it, whatever. Lester carries a Sphinx, but now Rita comes to him. He brushed her. No biting or kicking. Rick, you need Discord. We can talk about anything we like. Do they do lives on Discord? I think I have a Discord account. I got so many accounts I don't even use. I think I have an Instagram. Somebody else has a fake Instagram on me. Okay, here's a horsey question. Needing some tips on moving my mare when I arrived, should I put her in a stall or turnout alone or with others? How to introduce her to other horses? Just need to prepare for the first day. Well, there would be a lot of questions I have on that, Emily. Do you want to call in and let me ask you questions and we can talk about this topic? Let me give Emily a code if she wants to come in so I can ask her questions and we can discuss introducing a mare, because that's a pretty common topic that a lot of people have. And so where is it? All right, Emily, if you want to come in, that's only for Emily. Don't be trying to sneak in. I'll block you. I don't want to have 15 people trying to sneak in. Rick, I got to. All right, Emily, if you want to come in, copy this little steamyard.com, PTRZGBVTRR, and click it. And it'll bring you in the backstage, and I'll put you on. I'll ask you questions. See, somebody's telling you to call in. So I went past a lot of things. Yeah, they warned us about Y2K. That was the other thing I was thinking of when I was talking about. Remember Y2K when all the computers were going to shut down and infrastructure and water and you better plan, you better have plastic and tape. And I mean, they just went crazy on preparing and nothing happened. So Lester's still afraid of Rita, just saying. Poor Lester. Have you worked with many mules? No, I have not. But which ones, who's anxious, wondering if that's normal? Yeah, I don't know if it's normal or not. It looks like Emily came in. Look, horses are horses, mules, donkeys. They're all in an equine. They're all kind of fear-based, flight, survival instinct, prey animals. So they're all going to be suspicious, claustrophobic, flight, not very trusting of predators, which we are, unless we start some communication and we understand their language to talk to them in a non-threatening manner. Okay. So that is that. Emily is backstage. Hi, Emily.
Hello. How are you?
Good. How are you?
Good.
All right. So give me some background. What the hell's going on with this horse changing?
Okay. I commented a while ago about like tips for moving to boarding barns and everything. Well, luckily I found a private barn and I work there. So I'm like, it just makes more sense to move her from out of this boarding situation to where I work. She's 18 years old. She gets along with everybody. I think I'm overthinking about transferring her because I did want her to live outside 24/7. Unfortunately, like we do stalling and then turn out, I think like 8-9 hours depending, whatever. But I just, in my mind, I haven't really made a big move like this because I bought her from that boarding barn. She's always been at that boarding barn.
Where she's at now or where she's going?
Where she's at now.
Okay.
So this is like a big move for her, like, cause she's been at this boarding barn for years. So just to move her from a brand new location, new routine, new everything. Like just, I'm trying to picture in my mind, once I arrive there, do I put her out to the pasture? Do I let her settle in a stall? Do I turn her out alone with others or?
Okay. So we'll get to those in a sec. Let me get to a couple of things. So you said she's 18. Has she been at this barn she's at since she was a baby or just since you've had her?
Since I've.
Okay. So how long have you had her?
2 years.
Okay. So she's, my point is, she's moved and relocated before. It's not like she's been at this place and this is all she knows.
Right.
Okay. So that's a plus. It's not like if it was, she was there forever and she's never moved, it would probably change my answer a little bit because then I would think it would be more impacting. Right. 2 years at a place, it's a long time. She's comfortable. It's going to be stressful and shocking, but it won't be in the world because she's done it before, because when you got her, she moved.
Right.
Okay. And when you moved her the first time, was she at the barn or did you get her somewhere else and have her moved to the barn she's at?
Last summer, just for the summer, I had her at a different barn, but this was like, they made me quarantine her alone at first. Then we introduced like one mare over the fence and whatever, and then she was fine. But for this barn, they don't have a quarantine situation. It's just, they're leaving it up to me whether I want to put her in a stall or not.
How many horses are at this new barn?
She's going to be turned out with two bonded mares.
Okay. So that's a huge difference because I'm thinking big horses, blah, blah, maybe 15 horses. And we may do it a little different if there was 15 horses because she could get trapped. How big is the area, et cetera. Right. So the main keys when you're moving a horse to new areas, you don't want them to get trapped. You don't want to put them in with a herd that's really established to where they're the outside and there's going to be a leader and a lead mare, maybe an aggressive lead mare, or there's a stallion that's protecting his herd and they don't want to let this one in. Those would all change my answer, but we're talking two horses. What are the two? Do you know the two horses she's going in with?
Yes, because I work with them.
Okay. Are they male or female?
Both mares.
Both mares. Is she a mare?
Yes.
Okay. are they the same age as her or younger?
They're actually older. They're in their 20s. So they're just old brood mares.
Oh, so that's even better.
Yeah.
So the reason, if they were younger, there would be this pecking order, this older horse is coming in, there's a higher likelihood that there's going to be a challenge. Because they're both older and she's 18 and they kind of been hanging around, they don't, most mares don't want problems. Pecking order's not a big deal. She's kind of their age. If there's anything, she may be a little dominant because they're both older. Do either of them have injuries, limited mobility, limping, arthritis?
They both do, yes.
Okay, so she's going to come in as the young, healthy horse and probably want to take over. So the likelihood of her getting hurt is less. There's more of a likelihood that she may come in and be like, I got these two old mares here. I got to step up. I got to be the leader. So she's probably going to be prancing around. She may move them or chase them a little bit to say, right, hey, I'm the new mare. I'm in charge. So that, I would be more concerned about the two mares she's moving in with this information than her.
Right.
Yeah. So I think she's going to be fine. I might walk her out there with a lead rope. And since you already know the two horses, let them kind of sniff with a lead rope, kind of stay out of the way, hang back, you know, be ready because mares sometimes when they meet, and they kick and strike. So they do that little thing. So be aware of that, but let them maybe sniff, meet across the fence first, maybe put a little food right underneath the fence to where they can snack on both sides and they can't really fight.
Yep. Good idea.
And then they kind of sniff each other. They kind of work out their little issues through the fence. They both get to snack on the same hay. They figure out there's not a big threat here. Then maybe let her in. If they're okay, there's no problems. Maybe put a couple little piles out there to where they can kind of juggle and pick out a little food. Not a lot of food, just something to keep them occupied. And then they'll go to this herd. The two will probably go to one and she may go and try to push them off. or she may go to her own. It depends.
Now, do you think 3 is a bad number to turn out, though? Because now there is like gelding that's separate because I guess he's supposed to be off grass and whatever. He's high maintenance. But the choice was I turn her out with the one gelding or with these two mares where she'll be having grass and all this rich hay and everything else. So I was talking to the gelding's owner and she goes, oh, he's really dominant, really this, that. And then she's talking about if he's turned out with anybody, he gets all buddy sour and all that. So if 3, like, I don't know. I know they're all mares if it's just the 3 of them, but the 2 have been bonded for a while, right?
Yeah, I think you're overthinking it. It's no big deal. Yeah, okay. I don't. The woman with the gelding, that's typical. She's putting all her buddy sour. As soon as she said that means that if he's with another horse, I'm not the most important person's life. He doesn't come from me. It's too difficult to catch him or to deal with him because now he has something in his life besides me. So I don't like that because I'm selfish and I want to keep my horse alone. So I know I'm judging her and everything. I'm not trying to get you in trouble at your barn in case somebody sees this. But that's my initial opinion of her for saying that. If I had a horse alone, I'd be like, man, I'd love for him to have a mare. He'd have a buddy and they could hang out. But whatever.
Yeah.
I think probably the 2 mares is going to be a no-brainer, a no issue.
Okay.
Maybe a little bit of – how big of an area are we talking about? Like small or –
oh, no, big, very big. So I'm not worried about the fighting, but maybe the initial meet, the squealing and whatever.
Right. Yeah, the stomping and the striking, a little bit pounding the ground, showing. Yeah, but if they're too old and they're weak, they probably already know they're weak. They might be happy to have a strong mare in there that's younger because then they ain't got to worry about being a lookout. And they can let the young mare be the lead mare because horses like to either have a leader or they want to be a follower. They don't like the confusion. So. Sure. It's established now. They're both kind of like, okay, is one of the 2 that's in there now kind of the lead mare of the 2?
Yep. Oh, yes.
Okay. So she's established. So she's probably going to be the issue. The lower horse is going to be like, hey, I'm already lower to this one. I don't care which one takes charge. I'm already lower. So.
Exactly. Yep. That's exactly it.
Yeah. Yeah. So the lead mare may put up a little bit of a fight. There may be a little, you know, who's that? Your horse may go over and take the weaker mare to show her strength and take her a little bit away to show her dominance on the lead mare now to make the lead mare submit to her, saying, hey, I can take your herd. I'm stronger than you. If you fight me, I'm just going to take this one, and then you're going to have to ask me to come into my herd.
Right.
So, yeah, so there may be that, but it sounds pretty. Does any of them have horseshoes?
No.
That's good. Well, that's
good. So as soon as I get there, you recommend just taking her off the trailer straight to introducing them.
I don't know if I agree with that. Anytime I move a horse to a new area, I always like to get them out. I usually catch them on lead because they're usually like in high alert. Where am I? Is there any threats, predators, etc.? So I like to hold them. I'm holding on lead. I got them so they don't panic. I can kind of redirect them if I see them getting too jacked up. But let them sniff around, check it out. They'll see other horses. They'll see other things. They'll be picking up all the smells, all the threats, all the bad things. Let her calm down a minute with you. Maybe tie her to the trailer. Give her a brushing, something she's comfortable, routine. Mm-hmm. Bring her back to, okay, I guess I'm safe. I've done this before. This is cool. Bring her back to some familiarity. You brush her, maybe pick her feet. Just have a little time with her. Maybe sit down, whatever. Let her kind of work out her stress and frustration there for a second. And once she calms down a little bit, take her for a walk by the fence, maybe nose to nose, let her go see the gelding, let her go see the mares, let her go see other things. She'll calm down. She'll get some of that excess energy out. Oh my God, I'm at this new place. I got to be, and she'll get all that out of her. She'll be a little bit more tired and want to be relaxed. Then maybe do the feed between the fence to where they can eat on both sides. And then maybe just put her in and go, all right, I think I'm done. And if you want to go out when you let her loose, I would stand in the middle. Don't try to intervene too much. Stand in the middle. So if she does get insecure, she can always kind of run to you back to feel safe. Right. So if there's any problems, she'll have you as that little safety or security blanket. Okay. And then you stand out there and, kind of observe and figure it out. And I don't think it's going to be that big of a deal. I get anxiety and stress anytime I get my horses a new environment. Even if I trailer them out to go riding somewhere, I'm worried about, are they going to colic? Are they going to be okay? I mean, Buddy, I took Buddy to the vet with Mr. T, and he was shaking and shivering from the ride. And the vet's like, dude, man, I'm afraid he's going to tie up because he's so tensed and worried. And they were draining him. So he ended up getting a shot. I wouldn't even go with him. He was just coming as a, you know, a help to Mr. T. And he had to get shot because he was so stressed out from the vet ride, because I don't trailer him a lot. And it was a new place, and he got jacked up, and Mr. T was separated from him and put in this little thing and tied up. And he was like, what's going on? so you just never tell. But.
Yeah. Okay. Well, if you're curious, I might record the whole moving thing, because I was thinking about starting just some vlogs and whatever. I learned a lot. By the way, I've been watching you since I was so young, like 10 years ago.
Wow.
Yeah. So I've been around, like, the days you were at that other place with Sassy and
Roper.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, that was a long time ago.
Yeah, I'm a long time viewer, so
yeah. If you were there with Sassy, shit, I've been here for almost 12 years, and that was a year or so before I came here. So yeah, that is a long time.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Wow.
So yeah, so I might start a couple of my own videos if you're curious. I'm going to record the whole process. And
okay, so I think that's a good idea, and it's kind of cool, and I'd like to see it. But you need to be aware that if you're not focused on her and you're changing it because you haven't videotaped her before, or whatever, you're throwing in a new thing to create what's going on. What's this new thing here? I'm at a new place, and now she's doing this, and she's never done that before. And why is she doing that? So just be aware that it's going to distract you, and it may enhance a little bit of stress. I don't think it's going to be a critical issue, but be aware that your change of behavior, she's going to recognize that on top of being in a new place.
Right. I'll keep that in mind.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you. That really helped me out. That eased my mind a little bit. Well, I don't think it'll be a big deal, but
yeah, I don't think there is either. But I mean, the anxiety and the things that if we care about our animals, that's normal. I mean, I go through it too.
Yeah. Well, thanks, Rick.
All right, girl.
You have a great day.
You too.
All right. All right. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Okay. So, you know, when I move a guest out, my only option is it says kick guests out. So I don't know if when I click her out, if she gets some nasty message like you were just kicked out. It's not, that's the only way I know to remove you from the screen is my little option that says kick them out. Now, there's one below that that says ban them. And I don't mean to click that one if I accidentally did, but I just click kick her out of the stream and she left. So that's how I got her out. So if you got some nasty message that you were kicked out by the guy who hates women, whatever, that's not what happened. All right. So I didn't go to any comments while she was on there, but that probably would have been a good thing. Call in. So I guess that's where she was supposed to call in. Is the mini blind? That's a private. Emily sounds Kashnazian. Does that mean Canadian? Is that what you're saying? I don't know. I picked up a little accent too, but I didn't ask where she was at. Sometimes you don't want to, you know, people come on and you don't want to give out too information in case there's crazy stalkers or people trying to find you. So I don't want to get too personal on somebody. Yeah, someone else says she sounds Canadian. Can the Merrill trailer load? Well, I mean, I didn't ask that, but that would probably change my opinion a little bit if she hasn't been trailered out. And I probably should have asked that. Is she comfortable being trailered? Has she trailered before? Has she been to a vet? But she's obviously been trailered because she got to the place she's at. If she hasn't been trailered 2 years, the trailering will be stressful an event, but I mean, it happens. Horses accept their fate once they figure out they have no choice. So when you lock a horse up or tie up their feet and throw them on the ground or put them in a big bit and hurt them, they learn to accept their fate. It's like, I can't fight it. It hurts, or I'm going to die, or I fought the best fight I can and I give up. That's why the old saying is, it always gets worse before it gets better. When you're working on a horse and a horse is saying no, 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 and he's rearing and kicking and saying no, 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 right before he gives up and submits, he gives his final burst of fight to try to get out. So it gets worse. And then it's like, okay, I guess I can't get out. I give up. And then he accepts. So that's where that saying comes from. In horses, it always gets worse right before it gets better. My mom freaked out about Y2K. YouTube sucks. No argument with me there. Is she a mare? I got that out. Solar Eclipse cannot disrupt. I know. That's what I'm thinking. I'm like, why would that affect the grid, or you would have to have water or whatever? So I'm thinking that most of the warnings, the government is concerned about, you know, they're saying in Austin, they're expecting 200 to 400,000 people to come watch the eclipse. I don't know why, but that's what they're expecting. So they said it's going to be a drain on electrical resources. It's going to be a drain on the water resources. It's going to be a drain on traffic. It's going to be a drain on hospitals and services and police calls and accidents. And it's going to create problems. So you better be prepared if the problems get out of hand or there's some sort of major catastrophe because of all the problems compounding. You might want to have water and food on hand. I'm thinking that's where the warning comes from. But you never can tell with government because you never get the full story. And they're never completely truthful. So, has anyone heard of a hay bed? I watched a video of Mary giving birth. She delivered. They covered the stall in about 10 inches of hay instead of straw or shavings. I've never seen this. You know what? People do crazy shit. I haven't seen it. It doesn't surprise me. I hate the bedding when they put down on horses. When a mare has a horse, has her baby in the wild, she doesn't go dig a freaking hole or pull up shavings. She picks a spot with no rocks that's got a little cover shade, maybe out of the way, with maybe an escape path so she can get up and run. And she has her baby on the ground. She doesn't need shaving. She doesn't need straw. She doesn't need hay. She doesn't need a blanket. She doesn't need shit. They have their horse naturally, fine, without the women in pink, the saviors of the horse, making everything comfortable, and I have to be involved, and without me, it's going to be bad. And then you see these same women who do all this bullshit crying later. Oh, the mayor rejected the baby, and now I had to feed it, and it was rejected by the mean mom, and it rejected it because it was tired of you. It rejected you. You caused it, and you're blaming the mayor for rejecting your foal. But I digress. Have a sip of coffee and calm down. Freaking women and messing with moms trying to have their babies. All righty. Where are we at here? Welcome aboard, Sarah Cray. I guess Sarah Monty said she was a new user or something. It's stable, not nightclub. What does that mean? I don't know what the hell that means. Shannon's late. I like the California herd. I like that little herd too. Buddy and Mr. T, I like that little herd too. That was kind of a cute herd. Didn't like the people or California, but of course the horses were okay. Let's see here. Rick, I'm late. Where were you last week? Oh, you know what? I didn't do a live last week because I was kind of like, I was playing a lot of pickleball. I was tired. And I think I had a long live the night before and I was just like, I'm just going to take a Sunday off and just relax. And I wasn't going to even do one today because I was pissed off at YouTube for kicking me off last night. But the live last night was only an hour and a half. And since I didn't have to put in another 2 hours of editing and copying over to Rumble and BitChute, I was able to get off after they kicked me off, go down, relax, and chill out. And so I was like, yeah, well, like I said, if the sun was out, I was going to do a deferring live outside with the horses because they're both shedding pretty bad and I need to defer them. She implied later about trailering. Didn't get notification. Of course not. Emily says, I am Canadian. So obviously the people that picked that up knew that she was Canadian. And my mare trailer's fine. Okay, great. So that's good. So that's one less factor, you know, because a lot of people, when they move their horse first time or they make a big move, they've never trailered their horse. I mean, Lester was having the same problem. He was moving some of the horses and didn't know who to trailer with who and what mare and who got together. And I did a little live. I don't know if it was their live or my live, to where we talked about how they could deal with the trailering to the new place they were at. Master Rick. What do you think about multiple day trekking on a horse? I think when you say trekking, you're talking about multiple days of riding. Is that what they call the endurance riding, where they ride a horse all day for multiple days? I'm not a big fan of that for a lot of reasons. Unless you're going out every day on a horse and riding it, the horse doesn't develop the muscles, the ability to carry you. You work out the issues, the problem, you become a better rider. So if you don't do it every day, you're not as good at it, and the horse isn't as good at it. And most people I see doing these multiple things, they have it at a damn barn. They may ride for 30 minutes a day. They think they're experts. They think they're ready. They think their horse is in shape. They put it on a walker and they go, oh, my horse can go out trekking. He's made for it. He's a Tennessee walker. He's an endurance this. And they make all these excuses to put a horse through misery. And when a horse is carrying you through terrain for a day, it is very, very difficult. They can't drink. They can't eat. They're not able to relax. They've got your weight on them. They've got the saddle, the cinch constricting them. I mean, it's just like you putting in a hard day of work with a tight work belt on. And when you get that belt off and you're able to slip your shoes off, you're like, holy shit, I can relax. So when you put a horse through that for multiple days, I'm not a big fan of it, because I think it's more for the person. And it puts a lot of stress that people don't realize on a horse. So not a big fan. If you do it right, can a horse be taught and learn to work every day? Yes, there are horses that work on cattle farms every day. But you know what? They don't work all day. They work for 2 or 3 hours, and they have a string of horses, and you bring your horse back and you get a fresh horse. Because when a horse is actually working with somebody on their back, 2 to 3 hours is very, very difficult and stressful for a horse. Nobody works a horse on a working ranch for 8 hours a day, unless they're walking a fence line and they're doing fence repair. They'll strap on a couple things. They'll walk the fence to see if there's damages. When they get to an area, they'll hop off their horse, let the horse graze. It'll be a break. They'll fix a couple things. They'll get back on their horse and walk. Very low key. There's no running. There's no chasing cattle. There's no up and down hills, running, trotting, none of that. So then you may have a horse that can handle 6, 8 hours checking fence line. It's relaxed. It's all relative to a whole bunch of factors. All right. Where are we at here? Women should copy mares. Chief Smoke Lot is going to stir a problem with the women here. Rick, your show last night was gone. Yeah, I know. Free Spirit Equestrian had her foal in the paddock. Nice ground, no shavings. Okay, so again, I'm just judging this one comment here. So don't everybody have a shit fit on I got it wrong and I'm mean and I hate and blah, blah, blah. And I don't know what I'm talking about. I don't know what I'm talking about. So this person obviously thinks Free Spirit did a good job because she let her horse foal in a paddock on nice ground with no shavings. So from this comment alone, without seeing anything or knowing anybody involved, to qualify that, because people will be coming here, you know who you're talking about? Free Spirit's much better than you. She's smarter and you're just mean. You ain't. Shut up. From this comment, I like the fact that she had no shavings, because I think that's bad for horses. The baby gets it stuck on them. It's stuck on the placenta and the blood. And when the horse is licking and cleaning, they get all the shavings and bullshit that they wouldn't have in a wild. So I'm not a shavings, all this comfortable bullshit type person. So no shavings part, I like. I have no idea what else she did before or after. Was she there? Was she interfering? And then when I see in a paddock, I automatically think, why was it in a paddock? Was she locked in the paddock? Did the horse choose the paddock? And the horse could have chose outdoors, and the horse walked in the paddock, had the baby, and then took her baby out. There was no human involvement forcing the horse to have it in a paddock. If she forced it in a paddock, then I'm not a fan of free spirit. Rick, you can't hate her. She's really great. I don't know and I don't care. I'm just saying this when I read comments, this is how my little horsey brain goes through shit. I like no shavings. I don't like paddock. That's basically it. Okay? Well, Rick, if you'd have seen how she did it, she was really good. And all right, whatever. Harrisburg, Oregon. You read that wrong. I'm sure I read a lot of comments and sometimes I do read them wrong and I give this big dissertation on the wrong shit. And then I go back and I go, oh shit, that's not what it said. The thing you need to take from it is even though I read it wrong, is the point and the education and the experience and the thing that I'm talking about is that information that may help you. Even if I read the comment wrong, let's say I read it right, just for the sake of saying it. And what I'm saying helpful? Is it sharing information? Is it trying to help? And can you get anything from it? Okay? That's kind of where I go when people want to crack on me for reading shit wrong. Rick, am I being nosy? Are you monetized? I know you don't have... No, I'm not monetized. YouTube demonetized me on my horse videos. Lester horses are doing great. That's good. Lesta is too much of a beta male for me. Is beta male not an alpha? I know an alpha male is kind of like testosterone, tough ego, regular. What I call a regular male is an alpha male. Are you saying Lester's a little too sensitive and got his female side? I'm not sure what that comment means. The mic I was using doing your videos. Well, this mic is a different mic than the one I used in my last video where I had a little lapel mic. That worked pretty good. like using my shop vac on my percher. I think that means percheron male or mare doing sheddy seat. She loves the suction feel. Moki loves my little, I have a little, I don't know if I ever showed that. Did I ever show y'all my little, massage gun. I don't know if YouTube will freak out because it's called a massage gun. But it's got these different little things on it. I was going to do a video of me using it on Moki because he loves it. But it's a pretty cool little gun. If y'all want to see it, it's downstairs. I'll go get it. If I get enough people saying go get it, I'll go get it and show you what I'm talking about. Chief, agree on Lester Beta. Okay. See, I think Lester is probably more alpha male than you guys may say because I kind of talk to him a little bit off screen. And he's very concerned about his audience and not offending. And that may come off as different than who he really is. I'm not saying he's like a gun crazy anti-government testosterone guy like I think I am. I more lean to the more patriot, alpha male type. I'm not saying he's right where I'm at, but I don't think he's as beta as maybe you guys are seeing him. Could be wrong. One channel put hay in because they're in Canada and straw is not good there. She said it breaks down and turns into dust. She doesn't want them breeding it. She has issues before. Okay. Why put anything? You don't put anything. You don't have to worry about it. But Rick, then the poor little baby, her first experience of the world is going to be a hard ground with no fluffy feeling. Ah, crazy women. Shouldn't you let horses shed out naturally? Wouldn't BD shedding them potential causes issues later if the weather turns? Okay. That's a reasonable question. In Texas, usually February is our coldest month. You have to know where you're at. Usually winter's over after February, but March, every once in a while, you can get a surprise snow. So when the weather's, when the grass starts growing, you normally have, and the trees start blooming, is nature's way of kind of telling you winter's over. So if your trees are budding and your grass is growing, nature's telling me winter's over. Now, should you let them go naturally? You can. There is no reason. The only reason I de-shed them is because I get hair all over me. It's probably more for me than it is for them. I think they enjoy it. I think it makes them cooler in the warmer weather. However, if a cold snap or freeze comes in, they will have less hair because of my involvement and I removed it. Is that good or bad? We're almost, what are we, halfway through March? What's the thing? Oh shit, we're the 24th. So we're almost through March. Very rarely this late in March do we get anything. I mean, Texas may have gotten snow once in April in 20 years. Alexa, when is the last time it snowed in April in Texas?
From lovethemaldives.com. On April 7th, 2007, many areas from Crockett to Groveton and over toward Lufkin and Nacogdoches received 2 to 4 inches of snow.
So that was April 7th in 2007. So that was...
I don't know that one.
I wasn't talking to you, crazy woman. I'm done. Alexa, stop. So... she didn't answer the question. I can't remember the last time it snowed in April, but according to her, the April 7th, 2007, we had snow. So the odds of having snow this late in a season with all the trees budding, and there's the difference between a tree budding that is, what's it called? Native. So you have native trees for your area, and then you have man-made planted trees that aren't native. I have a lot of trees that aren't native. I got a peach tree, a pear tree. They're not really native to Texas. So sometimes they bloom. I had a couple cherry trees, and they would always bloom early because they didn't know Texas weather. So they thought as soon as April comes and the sun comes out, we get a couple days of 70, 80 degrees. They're like, oh, shit, summertime, bloom. And they bloom really quick, and then a freeze would come in and snap them, and they're both dead now. But I think they died from being flooded because we got a big rain for a long time, and it didn't dry out for 2 weeks. So I think they died for flooding, but maybe it was the cold. The native Texas trees, they know Texas weather, and they know how to survive. So when your native trees start budding out, you can pretty much be assured winter's probably over because they're pretty much on the timeline on what's going on for the area that they're native in. Can there be a fluke? Sure. All right. So that was that question. I don't know if anybody got anything out of that or if I was all wrong and I've got all these weather people, meteorologists in the comments telling me how I got it wrong. Pony Express. Those horses were traded every 2 to 3 hours, 20 miles. Yeah. Well, yeah, they were run hard. Most horses and the rancher have multiple mounts for trekking. Okay, well, if you're trading a horse out, even just getting on, there was one girl. I mean, I really liked her. She was young, she was immature. Her mom was nice. Her dad was nice. I liked them. And they had great horses. You probably heard me talk about Stewie, that one big draft horse I used to ride because the dad got cancer from Vietnam, ended up dying. And I kind of like was helping with the horse a little bit, and I'd ride it sometime. Huge horse. Love that horse. Their daughter thought she was Miss Horsewoman. She was, I don't know, 14 years old, 15 years old. And she had no fear. She'd get on a horse bareback and run the shit out of it. She had no fear. So a lot of people took that as she was Miss Horsewoman because she could ride a horse bareback fast and she had no fear. She did kind of have fear. I worked with a couple horses. I saw her doing some things and then she was really intimidated by a couple horses, but whatever. I'm not trying to trash on her. I'm just saying because she was young, she did things with horses that I thought an adult should have stepped in and went, that's not fair to the horse. You need to back off. And I remember one time we took these horses to the beach and she went out there and she took her horse. And I mean, literally for like 4 hours on the beach in the sand, which is twice as hard as running on solid ground. She ran the shit out of her horse literally 4 hours the whole time. The horse was nothing but sweating and panting for 4 hours. I actually thought, I said, that horse is going to tie up or die. I can't imagine. And you know what? The horse did fine. So I was wrong, but I still think what she did wasn't fair to the horse and wasn't good for the horse. But it worked out okay. See, that's the problem when people see things. If a horse doesn't die, they're like, oh, it must be okay. You know, I'll put a big bit in the mouth. If the horse doesn't fall over and die and he's not bleeding from the mouth, the big bit must be fine. So we have this misconception that just because a horse doesn't die, it must be good for the horse. I don't believe that, but whatever. All the comments keep disappearing. I don't know what that's about. I'm trying to call the platform. We are on a butthole. Not to try. I have no idea what that means. Blu-ray comic dude blocked it because they must be talking. No human involvement other iodine on. Okay. So for those that just read this comment like I just did, unless you connect it to previous topics, you probably like, what the hell is this comment? No human involvement other iodine on the umbilical cord. So when horsey are born, I think she's telling me that the girl that I was talking about that had the horse in a paddock, I was saying, you know, was she involved? Did the horse have a choice? Notice she didn't say she locked her in a stall, because that sounds like something I would disagree with, which I do, which she probably did, which I really don't care. I'm not trying to trash anybody. I'm just, my opinion. So she's trying to tell me this woman stayed out of it, and the only thing she did was put iodine on the umbilical cord. A lot of women think this is a mandatory, absolutely, the horse will die if you don't. I've been around a few babies that were born, and the first thing they do is they put a little iodine on in a glass, and they have to go over to the baby, and they usually just splash the iodine on the umbilical cord where it broke, and that supposedly saves a horse. Somehow, and I could be totally wrong here. I don't know the science behind it. I don't know the diseases that happens if it doesn't. My only thing is, in nature, there's no woman running around with a cup of iodine when a baby's born. And somehow, horses have babies in nature, and they do just fine. So, but I'm telling you, in the horse world, if you talk to any breeding woman, horse woman that had a baby, whatever, they are going to be obsessed with iodine on the umbilical cord when a baby is born. I've seen it over and over again. Maybe it's really needed. Maybe because of captivity or germs, or I don't know. My default is, if it's not done in the wild and horses survive, it's probably not necessary. But again, I could be wrong. All right. This Whitney girl is going to be like, this guy's an asshole. Every time I make a comment, all he does is try. It's not personal, Whitney. I don't know you. I don't know this woman. I don't really care about if either of you like me or hate me. I'm just talking horsey talk here. My opinion and experience. That's it. Let's see. Show us what you use on Moki. Please show us them. I guess I didn't show it. I'm surprised because Equate watches all my videos. I still have a half a cup of coffee and it's warm. I've been on for an hour. So let me run down and get the massage because it's on the... And I haven't used it on the horses yet, which I think the horses would probably like it. But, so here it is. It's got these little buttons here that you press. It's got these little attachments that you pull off. And here's the other attachments. It almost looks like YouTube's probably going to get me for porn. They're either going to get me because this is a massage gun. YouTube hates guns or anything that mentions guns because they're freaking left-wing little crybaby liberals that think guns are bad and guns kill people and guns are violent when guns are, you know, oh, this is a violent massage gun. Be careful with these guns because it's massage gun violence if you use it wrong and it hurts you. But anyway, I digress. So you have all these different, oh shit, I just dropped every damn thing. Freaking. Most people tell me to use this one because it's round. I put this one on because I can really get deep into the muscle. But, I mean, I think it was only 20, 30, maybe 40 bucks on Amazon. It's got all these little different things to get into your muscles for deep tissue massage. And then when you press this little thing here, what was my battery dead? Oh, shit. Oh, no, I got to turn it on. Sorry. It's got a little UBS plug here, and it's got a little, I forgot to turn this on. I haven't used it in a while. So when you turn it on, it gives it the power, and then you press this little button, and it starts vibrating. I don't know if you can see that. And when you get this on a muscle, oh, man, I mean it, test one, two. It's pretty good. It goes pretty deep. And on my pickleball arm, sometimes it hurts right here. And if I use this on it, it really helps. Oh, right there. Oh, man. So it really gets on the muscle, and I don't have to press that hard. So I use this attachment on Moki, and he loves it. He, like, lays over, and I'm rubbing him on the back. I go down his spine, and he's just like, oh. And he rolls over. I do his little rib cage. I haven't used it on a horse yet, but I'm sure if a horse had muscle issue, it increases blood flow. It works out knots. I usually use it on my hip right here. Right there on that hip. And so it gets into the muscles. So, but Moki loves it. And you can go, I never go past one. But they have, shit. How do I go up? Shit. Oh, there it is. One, two, one. Hang on. Two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. Oh, no, sevens. So I don't ever use it on that high because it freaking, I mean, I could. Test one, two. Welcome to the horsey channel. So anyway, that's the massage gun. And don't forget to turn it off or you'll be recharging it. So that's what Moki likes. If you want to get one for your horse, I think it would work on your horse. I think it would be actually pretty good because a horse has a large, huge muscles. And if they were sore and you use this on it, I bet it would make them feel good. I would like for some college to do a study. They say when a horse colics, they have belly problems, gas, whatever, trapped. Remember, they have like 75 feet of intestines twisting around in there. So it's easy for bad hay or gas or, you know, it's like a freaking chemical plant in there. They say sometimes when a horse colics, if you tap on their belly, it moves little air bubbles and it kind of vibrates or shakes their intestines, which will sometimes cause the blockage in their belly to pass. So that's one of the old colic treatments for a horse is colicking. You walk them, you try to get them to poop, because usually when they're colic, things stop moving. They stop pooping, they stop farting, and everything stays in there. By walking, sometimes it causes them to poop or fart. Well, some people say this vibrates the intestines inside, and that sometimes helps a horse that's colicking. I would like a college to do a study on horses that are colicking. If this put on a horse's belly, vibrating the intestines might be a cure or help for colic. to me, it makes sense. This would help, I think. No scientific proof, but it makes sense. And that would help. You burp a baby, right? When a baby has blockage or gas, you put them on your shoulder and they burp. Why wouldn't this work on a horse? Horses can't burp. I mean, they can't vomit. Once it goes in, it's got to go out the only ways. One way in, one way out, period. So why wouldn't that help? Inquiring minds want to know. All right. So let's see. I turned off Lester when he let the trespasser go without he punched him. Yeah, the trespasser, I think I would have chased that bad boy down. I would have been much more aggressive on that video too. But I understand Lester had Jamie with him. He wasn't prepared. He didn't have a gun with him. He wasn't armed. I get he had some decisions to make. Oh, that's a very good point. Because Lester was a teacher and he had to deal with parents, he's much more careful in his videos. Makes sense. Wind's really picking up out there. I hear it blowing on the window screens. Let's see. Lester and Ray. Okay, March to April can get a surprise snow. Yeah. Yeah, I agree. I mean, Texas can get those little weird cold fronts that just blast through here. You're like, what the hell? But if a cold front does come through, it's usually short-lived. It's not a week. And to be honest, if I brush a horse and I take off a lot of his fur and a cold front comes in, they can start growing new hair relatively quick. If I take a horse from Texas and I drive him 8 hours up a mountain and we're at 4,000 feet or 5,000 feet, and it gets really cold at night, they will start growing fur almost immediately. And within a couple days, you'll see that they have a thicker coat. So they adjust very rapidly, no different than if they're coming out of summer and there's an early snowstorm. That's not normal. And they don't have a winter coat. They'll probably still make it. Is it best or worse? I mean, I don't think brushing a horse toward the end of what you think is winter is going to kill it if a short winter freeze. Now, Texas doesn't have big winters anyway. Now, North Dakota, Alaska, Minnesota, those places, I would be much less likely to take away my horse's protection. And again, if let's say I did brush him and I took away and we had a cold front, I have blankets for an emergency. Could I blanket them? I don't like to. I probably wouldn't. It would depend on whether it was wet, snowy, rain, whatever. There'd be a lot of factors. All right, I challenge anyone to really piss Lester off and see how you make out. Oh, when I first read this, I thought they were going to say Lester will never lose his temper and you can't piss him off. When I first started reading this, and then I got, and see how you make out, this guy is saying that Lester can have a wrath and can take care of business if he has to. I would agree with that. And when did I see him that he was freaking? Well, when Carl was trying to kill his ass, he was able to get pretty aggressive. So, I mean, Lester's a corn-fed Texas boy. He's corn-fed Texas boy. He can probably pull out some mojo when he has to. All righty. I saw Voodoo with Jamie video. He looks okay. I don't know if they're talking about Voodoo now. Your Alexa got triggered. if you want to know what this name is, you have to copy and paste all the zeros and ones and then put it in a Google Translator and it will tell you what this word is. So all these zeros and ones is actually a name. But I just don't feel like figuring out what it is. But if you want to, you can. I watch you for a while now. I had a feeling I was going to end up with horses later in life, but sadly, there's almost no way to learn the right way here in the Netherlands. It's all bits and whips. Yeah. Well, I mean, the only thing I would disagree is it's not impossible to learn the right way, because there's plenty of videos and there's plenty of education free online on what you can decide is the right way. What I think you're kind of saying is the only actual experience that you're going to get there is they all do it the same way and they're all bits and bad ways. So you're not going to have the example there of any right ways, but there's plenty of examples online that you can learn and do the right way and experiment with yourself. West Texas, much higher altitudes. Yeah, I would agree. If you're up by north of the panhandle, maybe, I think Abilene tends to get a lot of snow. Is it Abilene or what's the one I'm thinking of? Wichita Falls, that's about an hour or 2 hours north of me. They might get a little snow. There's a few northern places in Texas that, again, know your environment. I'm in North Texas, but I'm so close to Dallas. I kind of go with Dallas-Fort Worth weather, and it's not going to snow a whole bunch in April around Dallas-Fort Worth. Alexa is evil. Alexa is no more evil than a gun or a car or gasoline or a knife. It is how people use it and what they do with it that makes it evil. Now, I will admit the programmers of the answers is swayed and you can't always trust the information, but I don't think just having Alexa itself is evil, so to speak. You smoke a lot, making some cheese out of trespassers. invasive trees. Yeah, I don't know if I said invasive. Did I say invasive? I meant either native or non-native. If I use the term invasive, that's not what I meant. Treason is listening advice. Look, I'm going to say it again because it just kills me when people blame my little Alex device as being a government whispering device. If you want, oh, I don't have my phone up here. I don't know where the hell my phone's at. It must be downstairs somewhere. Everybody has a phone, and that is the number one government tracker, follower, listener. It's got a videotape and a camera, or not videotape. It's got a video device, recording device, a camera, and a GPS device. If you're worried about my little Alex being a problem and you carry around a phone, you are misinformed. Because I assure you, my little thing in my house only hears me when I'm in my house. It doesn't have a camera and it can't video or take pictures. So your phone is a much greater aid to the government than my little device sitting here answering my questions, giving me the weather, listening to the news, playing music when I want. All right, where are we at here? I'm surprised I didn't get any feedback on advice on moving the horses. Logan, it's just lasting impression. Tennessee law says you can blast any trespasser's ass. I love it. Good. What does tying up mean? So tying up is, that's probably a pretty good question. I wonder if, Alexa, what does it mean when a horse ties up?
From horseracingsense.com, when a horse ties up, it experiences severe muscle cramping or damage, generally accompanied by distress and an inability to move freely.
Okay, I'm not, I don't know if I like that definition so much. Let me see what this says. So according to...
I don't have an answer for
that. Oh, I wasn't talking to you, crazy woman. I was done with you. Alexa, stop. So If I was going to describe tying up without her, muscle spasms is a good way to do it. The muscles get really tense. It's like a cramping. If you ever cramp or you ever work really, really hard and you're sweating and you may get a little like shivering or shaking or your muscle shakes. If you've ever gone in a fight or flight, really nervous when I was a cop and we would either get in a pursuit or somebody would shoot or we'd get in a really high stress situation, it's very common for either my leg or my arm to shake a little bit because you get this blood adrenaline rush and your body, it's a way to use all that excess adrenaline and it gets rid of it. So when a horse starts shaking, shivering, cramping, or muscle spasms, they can tie up. Now, I don't know if they can die from it, but I have seen horses fall on the ground and can't get up on it. And you have to treat it. I think we're going to look it up here. I think you treat it as shock, the same things you would treat somebody going into shock. Keep them warm, maybe get them in the shade out of the sun, cool them down, calm them down some way. But let's see what Google and IA has to say on all this. Not IA, AI. Tying up, also known as asturia. Oh, never heard of that. Never knew that word. Is a muscle metabolism condition that causes painful muscle cramping in horses, usually during or after exercise. Here are some signs. Reluctance to move. The horse may take short steps, feeling unsteady, stiff on its back legs, and unable to move. Muscle spasms. The horse may twitch, tremble, or have cramping in the hindquarters. Okay. When Buddy was doing it, his front chest muscles were literally just back and forth, just shivering and shaking. And he was like this. The vet was like, damn, I'm worried about him tying up. I'm going to go ahead and give him a shot to calm him down. So that's how he was getting rid of his nervousness. Breathing and heart rate. The horse may breathe quickly and shallowly, having rapid heart rate. Sweating. The horse will sweat. Buddy was sweating. Legs. He was standing there shaking and starting to sweat. Other symptoms. The horse may have reddish brown coffee colored urine. That's dehydration thing. Paw the ground or attempt to lay down. If your horse showing signs of tying up, you should stop the activity. Yes. Move the horse to a box stall. I don't know about that. Call a vet. Yes. Blanket the horse if the weather is cool. Yeah, because he's getting cold. He's shivering. That could cause tying up. Determine if the horse is dehydrated. Not much you can do about how. You can lead a horse to water. You can't make him drink. A vet could give him an IV or give him some water. Sometimes they'll shove a hose up their nose straight into their stomach, and they'll just force like a gallon of water straight into their stomach. And that will help with the dehydration because you can't make them drink. So you just shoot the water straight into their belly. Provide fluids, sips of water. Relieve the anxiety or pain. A lot of people, if a horse is tying up, they'll say, give them a, what's that horse aspirin? I can't think of it. Not Benadryl. Shit. You guys will know it. I don't use it a whole bunch, but it's like the cure all for horses. Oh, give them Bute. That's the thing I'm looking at. Give them Bute. They have it in tablets or paste form, and you give them a little Bute. To me, I just call it a heavy duty aspirin for a horse, and it usually is a semi painkiller, anti-inflammatory kind of drug. So a lot of people will say, if your horse is tying up, give them some Bute. Relieve anxiety and pain. Remove grain and feed. Provide only hay until signs subside. You can reduce risk of tying up by ensuring adequate electrolytes and water, ensuring your horse is meeting its vitamin E and psyllium requirements, supporting electrolyte balance, feeding low starch, high fat diet. So anyway, some horses need to be maintained on sedatives prior to exercise or daily medication to decrease and prevent muscle damage during tying up episodes. So there's your little spiel on tying up, if you didn't know what it was or never heard it before. Hell, I'm an hour and a half already. What time is it? 11:30. All right, I'm doing okay. I turned my heater up. It's getting warmer. Alexa, set the thermostat to 68.
The heat's set to 68.
Chief,
I'm not sure.
I wasn't talking to you, crazy woman. I really have to turn off this. Alexa, stop. Usually I have a follow-up question. When I ask Alexa a question, she'll answer it, and it's not the question I want. And if you don't turn on this technique to where she's ready for a follow-up question, as soon as you ask her a question, she goes off, and then I have to repeat and say, Alexa, again, stop. So I just told her stop. So in order to prevent me, because I usually always have a follow-up question to her answer because she either misinterprets what I'm asking, she doesn't give me the answer I'm looking for, I revise the question that I ask her to get a better answer. And but so I don't have to say her name again, I have the thing, you can go on the app and turn on prepare or always be ready for follow-up question, something to that effect. And I have that turned on. But it's kind of a pain when I'm doing my lives because she's always listening. Normally when I ask a question, I move on with the answer. If I don't have another question, she just goes off. She waits for like 5 seconds. If I don't answer, she goes off. But when I'm doing lives and I'm talking, whenever I ask her a question, because I continue to talk, she thinks I'm asking another question. So she tries to answer. So it's a pain in the butt when I'm doing the lives, but it's kind of handy when I'm doing normal. So that's why I'm having problems with her, in case somebody. On top of that, she's a woman, and you know they can never shut up or know when to not talk. And Rick, you just hate women. You can't. Oh, whatever, you big crybaby, rice paper feeling, wanting to be offended. The iodine helps the cord to dry up quickly. Okay. I mean, whatever. Like I said, I my default is, if it's not done in a while, like blanketing and shaving and horseshoes, and I don't usually mess with it. Now, trimming, it's not done in a while, but because our horses aren't traveling 25 miles a day, they don't wear down their hooves. So when we have a horse in domestication, I think trimming is something where humans need to get involved. You need to give your horse hoof care. We're feeding them high grains, fertilized hay, good food. We make most of our horses overweight, and all that increases the hoof growth. And when you have increased hoof growth and less activity in walking, you're going to have overgrown hooves. So trimming is one of those things where my default is, if they don't do it in a while, I don't do it. That's different when it comes to hoof care. I know people call me hypocrite. Rick, you can't do that. So you're going to be mad at women because they trim, but you're going to trim their feet and they don't do that in a while. And you're just a hypocrite. If you want to find a way to call me a name, knock yourself out, whatever, you freaking crazy people. I can't deal with all the crazy people in my life right now. I got too many right now. I've never put iodine on my sheep in biblical cords, but boy, did I get heaps of advice to do so. There is no shortage of advice in the animal care kingdom. You must wear a COVID mask and hand sanitizer. We should start that rumor, and I should probably put that out and just watch how quick it runs. Because if you start something crazy in a horse world and you have a few women catch onto it and latch onto it and they think it's a good idea and great, that shit will be like mandatory within 6 months. I'm not a big fan of this suggestion. If the ground is wet when a foal comes, we use chlorhexidine on new foals. So chlorhexidine, I use it. It's a very good, kind of like betadine, iodine, antibacterial kind of stuff. Chlorhexidine is pretty cool. Actually, I think they use it when they do dental work on horses to kill all the bacteria when they do it. Even I think human dentists may use chlorhexidine. I think I read that it's used in medical purposes in dentistry for humans. But chlorhexidine is a very, wipes out a lot of good and bad, and you don't want a horse drinking or following. You don't, if a cat licks or drinks chlorhexidine, he dies. So it's very dangerous if you have cats to use you know, I keep it in a spray bottle. And when my horses have an infection or something, I will spray it with a little chlorhexidine, and it really dries it up and kills most anything. But I'm very cognitive of, I have Moki running around and I don't want it on the ground. So if I use it around the horses, I always make sure it's very diluted and spray down and rinse the area, so a cat doesn't come by and lick it. And so again, when you use these things, you have to learn on how it affects other animals. So I like chlorhexidine. I'm not anti-chlorhexidine. I have a big gallon of it. I think it's a great antibacterial cleaning agent, and it cleans shit really good. But you got to be careful with cats, and you don't want to use it all the time on everything, of course, because then it becomes less effective in immunity, et cetera. And I think chlorhexidine might be an antifungal. So when horses get fungal stuff, I think it works, or I'm not sure. I don't want to give the wrong information. Research it. It's good. I have it and I use it. Pistol grip. Oh yeah. Because it has a pistol grip, even though it's a massage gun, it's probably illegal in California. So the ones in California may not have this pistol grip because it's too much like a gun. You may only get this part in California. Looks like a hairdryer. It does kind of look like a hairdryer now that you said that. Please massage your leg. We need to see how it works. I think I did, didn't I? It really works good down this front. So here's where my leg really gets bad. Right here. It's really, really like... Oh, I got to turn it on. It's not working now. Oh, there it is. So right... Oh, shit. And when you rub it on your leg right here, you can actually feel the knots in your muscle as it hits the knots. So here there's no knots. Oh, right there's a knot. And it goes back and forth over that knot. Oh, but the more I do it, the knot disappears and it breaks down that tissue and cartilage. It's really a good little tool. One of my pickleball girls turned me onto it. She like swore by it and I went, really? And then when I got it, I was like, I think she wanted me to get this. This is kind of like a woman toy thing. And then when I used it, I was like, that thing works pretty damn good. And it's not that expensive. And I think I've charged it once. I've had it for probably 4 to 6 months, and I've charged it once. So I don't use it a whole bunch, but it keeps a pretty good charge. Moki happy new massage toy. I guess I'm behind on comments. I'm getting all these. You need a half naked girl to massage. Chief, let's not go there. Although I thought about it. Buddy and Ransom. Yeah, I do want to use it on them just to, oh, I forgot to turn this off because that little light stays on if you don't turn it off. I do want to use it on the horses. If not, because I think Ransom is going to be like, get that thing away from me. No, because he's kind of a no person. I don't think Buddy will really care, but I think Ransom's going to tell me no, and I'll be able to use this to show how to get him used to it in a video. So I do plan on doing a video with that on the horses. My back hurts so bad, man. I'm telling you, you can use it on your back and shoulders. You can reach around. I guarantee you, if one of you guys get one, you're going to be like, Rick, thanks so much for recommending that. That thing works wonders. Wisconsin, because you're late, Jen, you have to get down, drop down and give me 20 push-ups right now. They use the massage guns on the 15 horses. Oh, no kidding. Wow. So somebody's already using it. I figured it would be. It's not like it's a short leap. If you find something good for you, that it's probably good for the horse. Does it have a banana magazine? So a banana magazine, they call it a banana clip. It's usually a curved clip instead of a straight one. So I'll probably have like 100 around here. Let me show, because a lot of people aren't gun people. So they don't know what a banana clip is. So this is what is commonly referred to as a banana clip because it curves. If it's just straight, if this was just a straight clip, that would be a straight clip. But a banana clip, because it curves like a banana, that's what they're talking about. And this holds bullets. I think I can still show bullets on YouTube. I'm not sure. Maybe I can't. Maybe I'll cover them up. So there's not bullets in there. It's just empty. Anyway, this is what a banana clip is. So they're saying, does this gun have a banana clip here? YouTube's going to cut me off. If I get cut off, I'm ending the live, whatever. If YouTube cuts me off because I'm talking about guns, because I'll freak out. Elbows for massaging, colicking horses, gut area. Oh, really? See? To me, it just makes sense. So I've never heard of the elbow massaging the gut area, but I have heard of the on the belly around the gut area to get air bubbles and things stimulated. And when you're walking, things are rubbing and moving. That's what supposedly helps the horse pass gas or stimulate them. So if you're not walking, that doesn't work. This is another way to do the same thing. Some of you guys may try that on your pregnant wife. If she's not feeling good, just start doing that and it might make her feel better. Rick, you're going to get in trouble. A massager. I will do a video on them on using the massager on. Let's see. I just went out to chop my Jeep. I went out to chop my Jeep out of a blanket of ice. Stormed all day. Wow. Rick, do you think a bit adds to safety of riders and those around them whatsoever? I've seen people say gives them extra brake. Yeah, absolutely disagree 100% with that. A bit is the worst thing that you could do to give to somebody that's scared of a horse so they can't stop a horse. The way you stop a horse is you turn his head and you point his nose to your hip area and to his butt area, and it makes him go in a circle and he can't run forward. A horse, you won't show me a video of a horse with his head facing his butt that's running forward. Just ain't gonna happen. Okay, their head is a counterbalance. And you need, a horse needs his head when he's running, has this counterbalance for his gallop and moving. And when you turn his head like this, he cannot go forward. So you will not see a horse running when his head is turned. Now, because we have weak, frail women that shouldn't be riding, that don't have the strength to ride, and because they can't do that, they think a bit makes them feel safe. It just increases the pain. It gives them leverage and pain to do things they can't do without the bit. The problem with using pain and force on a horse is more often than not, you get the wrong result on what you were planning. And I told this story before. My buddy lives in Montana. He's got horses. We were cops together in Woodland. And when we worked in Sacramento, he worked at the sheriff's department. I was working with the task force out there. So we've worked together for years and everything. He got out. He didn't have horses. I had a horse. He told me I was crazy. Horses were dangerous, going to kick me and all that. He moves to Montana. Now he's got a horse. He's Mr. Horse Guy. And so he rides and he works and he goes out and chases cattle and up in the mountains. And I mean, it sounds like he's getting really great horse experience. And I can tell by talking to him, listen to him, he's starting to understand horses better. He still uses bits. He knows I'm against bits, but he's just not going to go. He's got bits on his horses. So he has this horse that runs off with his wife and she can't stop it. And his fix, he didn't tell me this before, he told me afterwards. So he goes, yeah, man. He goes, man, I made this huge mistake. And then he goes, you know, it cost my wife to get hurt. And I go, what happened? He goes, well, her horse was running off on her. And, you know, she said the bit wasn't working. And I was like, okay, I got a bigger bit. So I gave her this bigger bit with longer shanks. And when the horse ran off, she got scared and yanked back really hard. The horse reared up, flipped over on top of her. And I'm, when he's telling me this, I'm like, as soon as he said I gave her a bigger bit, my first thought was, dude, don't ever give somebody that can't control a horse without a bit, a bigger bit. It's only going to make the problem worse. They're going to pull the horse over on top of them. They're going to strip the horse's head one way or the other. A horse will fall on them and trip and fall. You don't give somebody that can't do something that's incompetent, you don't give them a bigger pain device in order to force compliance on a horse that wants to run away from them. That's never the answer. But in the horse world, everybody thinks it works because sometimes it can work. But in this case, it didn't work. She flipped the horse over and got hurt. And then he goes, man, he goes, I realized as soon as I did it, I was like, I should have never gave her that bitter bit because I knew she was going to yank on it and I knew it was too much. And I meant to tell her, don't pull hard. But when she got scared, she yanked hard and the horse flipped right over. Why did the horse flip on her? Not because he was trying to kill her, because it hurts so much. When you pull on a bit, the horse will raise his head. And when a horse raises his head and you're still pulling and creating pain, he tries to rear to escape that pain and pressure of pulling, and he flips backwards or falls over on you and breaks your leg. It's just a horrible. And yet you ask any women, 99% of women out there, they will tell you a bit makes a horse safer and you can stop it. Go to a bit store. Sometimes when I go to these freaking stores to get my food, I just look at the bit aisle to see what other pain devices they've kind of remedied now to sell to stupid women in pink. I see pink bits in there now to sell to dumbass women because it's pink. It must be nice. And they sell them or they wouldn't be on a shelf. And I just look at some of the crazy bits out there and they name these bits the feel good bit, the better stop bit. For the horse that likes to run, this will help encourage them to stop. They put all these fancy dumbass words that I interpret as this just means more pain. You're just giving a bit that hurts the horse more to get them to stop. You're not teaching the person the fundamentals. You're not helping the horse. You are simply creating a dangerous situation where you're going to encourage somebody that doesn't understand what pain does to a horse, doesn't understand how a horse mechanic works and how to stop a horse. You give them something with pain. It's just stupid. But it's kind of like a cop saying, you don't want to put your hands behind your back, so I'm going to take an electrical charge taser and I'm going to shock you. And then I'm going to tell you to put your hands behind your back while I'm shocking you. That's just stupid. Nobody can comply when they're being shocked. They're panicking. They're like, ow, it freaking hurts. Stop. And they're trying to defend themselves from the pain. And if you can't make the correlation between why a person doesn't listen when they're being shocked and don't put their hands behind their back, and dumbass cops are like, oh no, we taser them in order to get compliance. It helps them comply. It stops their resistance. It's stupid. It doesn't stop anything. It creates pain on a person and they fight more. And then the cops can either shoot them or use more force on them. It's stupid. But if you listen to people, they'll say, oh no, a taser is better. It helps people. And if you listen to dumbass horse people, they'll say, oh no, a bit in the horse sensitive gums and teeth, it's better if it's bigger. It helps them stop better. It's just ignorant, any way you shape it. All right, now that I went off on that freaking tangent. what are we at here? I'm an hour and 48 minutes. I want to keep this to 2 hours. Lester and Carl. I'm working my way down. Lester's dad used a massage gun on his donkey, Ivan, when he had tetanus or tinnitus? Tetanus, I guess. And it helped big time. El Paso. What is this? I can watch Minimize Rick YouTube and play dominoes at the same time. Rick, what's your phone number? Oh, sure. It's 940-333-66227. You can replay that. Give me a call anytime. Get my damn phone number. Are you kidding me? let's see here. Buildup of lactic acid. Work better than the vet. I don't know what we're talking about there. Colic. Somebody doesn't know what colic is. Colic is basically a stomach ache for a horse. It's a pain because horses have these huge, you know, 75, 125 feet of small and large intestine. I think they have 75 feet of large intestine and 35 or something feet of short of small intestine. So when you have all that intestine twist and turn in the gut, sometimes a horse will have gas. And when they have gas buildup, or if they eat something and it blocks the flow, it causes pressure and pain. Sometimes they need surgery. Sometimes most times it'll just pass. But when a horse gets in pain in their gut and they don't know why, they try to stop it by kicking, sweating, running, rolling. And usually all those things make it worse. Sometimes it'll help clear it, but the horse is just reacting to the pain in their gut. So colic is basically a stomach ache on steroids, and the horse reacts to it many different ways that can make it worse. Where are we at here? Butte. Yeah, that's when I was trying to look for that word. Butte is what I was looking for. Everybody knew what I was talking about but me. Wow, must be hard behind. I thought I talked about butte a long time ago. My comments just jump. What happened to the live last night? I talked about that earlier in this live. I sent you an email. No, I've not checked my email in probably 2 days. I have, let's see, I don't have my phone up here. I think I have like 250 unread emails last time I checked. morning, Rick. Want to feed my horses? I'm confused. If Rick is being punished on YouTube, how is this live happening? Because I have another channel, and because of my other channel is Good Luck America, the strike is against that channel, so I can't post or do anything on that channel. Think Like a Horse is a different channel. I don't have a strike. Think Like a Dog is a different channel. I don't have a strike on that. So because I have a strike on one channel, it doesn't affect all my channels. Hey, Rick, love your horseback riding videos. They've helped me lots. When are you going to ride Buddy again? Will you stay in the pasture? Yeah, I'll stay in the pasture with Ransom when I ride Buddy. I won't ride him out. I mean, Buddy doesn't like to ride out by himself. He gets kind of nervous. I mean, he likes to go visit. I might take him down a road or so, but it's just going to be a maintenance ride. Get him on my back, run him a little bit, exercise so he remembers that if I have to ride him, I can. So he can't tell me no, develop some muscles, stretch him out a little bit, carrying me, et cetera. Let's see. Thanks for explaining. You're welcome. A roller. I have the roller also. It's this little two-hand thing. I keep that in my pickleball bag. And I just roll that up and down on my leg, and it mashes the muscle and spreads it out. When you spread out a muscle like that, after you stop putting pressure on it, it allows blood flow to get back in there. So you're creating blood flow by mashing, and then it refills. Now, at the gym, they have the big foam balls that you lean on, and you roll your body back and forth on it. It does the same thing. They have the hand, they have the roller, they have the gun. There's lots of things, though, to use for your muscles. Rick was wearing a cooking apron, dancing, putting on lipstick. What? I don't remember. I was looking up. Is my cornbread thing still up? No. Man, I was trying to think of this one place had great cornbread, and I couldn't remember the place. It was like sweet, and they put jalapenos and the red pimentos, like from olives, in there, and the corn, like the Spanish corn with all the veggies. So there was whole corn in the cornbread, and I think they used brown sugar and some cheddar cheese. And then they cooked it in a cast iron skillet, so it got this crispy crust. And then when you cut it, the brown sugar was a sweetness, and then the jalapenos they put in were spicy. And then the corn with all the coloring. It was the best damn cornbread. We used to go to this place all the time in California. I cannot remember where it was. I remember we used to go there and have wine, and they had good steak and pork chops there too. But we were talking about cornbread this morning, and I couldn't remember what the name of the place or how to make that cornbread. It was really good. So if you look up spicy cornbread and you look at images on Google, you will see a lot of the pictures that I was talking about and just described. All right. You don't like bits, but what is your take on people writing with just a net rope? Looks like would be uncomfortable. A neck rope. So I'm not a big fan of the net rope because I think it's kind of a cliche and it's kind of cool and it really doesn't give you stopping power in emergency. The horse's nose is your stopping power. If I can bend that nose or direct that nose down or up, when you put on a neck rope on a horse and you're pulling here, you may restrict blood flow, but you don't restrict the head. So the head can stay in a straightforward position, also known as bracing. If you pull on a horse and he'll stiffen his neck and head and just push through the bit, he will brace. When you use a neck rope, a horse can brace through it. So you do not have stopping power with a neck rope. It may look cool, and I'll ride my horses maybe around the pasture, in a round pen, or in an arena, because my horse can't run off. If he runs off, I'll just ride it till he gets tired, because I can't stop him. There's no dangers. But to ride out in open areas where cars and cliffs and dangers and trees and ditches, and you go out with just a neck rope, I think that's dangerous and probably not too smart. Because if your horse wants to run away, or if a motorcycle jumps out, or a bear comes after you, you are not stopping a horse with a neck rope. If I have a rope halter on, I can turn my horse's head and stop him. I don't care how dangerous he's running. I can stop him. But with a neck rope, you cannot. So I'm okay with neck ropes to show that your horse will listen to you in a controlled small environment. But if you use a neck rope in an uncontrolled environment to where your horse could get scared and run off, I think you're being dangerous. You're risking him running out into traffic and getting you and him killed. You're risking him running into a ditch, through a ditch, breaking his leg, through rocks, because you are not stopping a horse that is scared in flight mode with just a neck rope around his neck. It ain't happening. Now, in a crisis, maybe you could reach up, grab an ear, lean over his neck and grab his freaking nose and start cocking his head and maybe slow him down, but you're probably going to fall off. But you may be able to control him a little bit like that. But if you can't control that head left or right, you ain't stopping a horse when he wants to run. Now, if you put a big ass bit in his mouth with long shanks with 20 to 1 pound pressure and you're tweaking a chain underneath his jaw and you're pulling and gagging him, then you can probably stop him because the pain will override his ability to push through it. But that's very bad. Anyway, I'm at 158. I got to move forward to get through here. So I'm going to start shooting past. Thanks for live stream. Man, I'm way behind on my comments. Neck ropes called Liberty. I'm caught up. This is my last comment. Perfect. Cora Kega, but I did a vet check for your horses for kissing spine. What the hell is that comment? All right. So I'm going to end this. I'm at 1 hour and 58 minutes. Hope you got something out of it. Now you know what a banana clip is. You know what a massage gun is. You know what a massage gun with a 30-round banana clip is. Hopefully you're all better horsey people now because of this great life. All right, I'm out. Y'all have fun. And I'm going to go figure out what I'm going to eat, go check on the horses and critters and finish my Sunday. Y'all have a good day, and we'll chat with y'all later. See ya.